You know, I'm convinced of this. We do not preach salvation in the day in which we live. We preach forgiveness. You want to be forgiven? Shed a few tears. Get your name in the book of life. Get your name on the waiting list for a crown. You get a ticket to the marriage supper of the Lamb. And a few other benefits. It's my conviction, dear pastor, that we live in a day of spiritual ignorance. Do you know what would do good if and I'm not suggesting, I'll suggest it, you don't have to do it. But you know, if you ask somebody, are you saved? You say yes. If you say to them, are you regenerated? They say, well, let me check with the pastor. Are you adopted? Are you reconciled? Are you forgiven? Are you pardoned? Are you justified? They're all areas, they're all spokes in the same wheel, but they all mean something different. Redemption is a magnificent thing. The life of God in the soul of man. Let me tell you this, listen, with all the power I have, Jesus did not come into the world to make bad men good. He came into the world to make dead men live. Not to make bad men good, to make dead men live. Christianity is the only religion in the world, whether you have 1,000 or 2,000, it is the only religion in the world where a man's God comes and lives inside of him. You can give up your lousy smoking and rotten women and drinking and not be regenerate. You see, we're awfully easy on the sin problem. You see, you're one of God's little children, and if you commit adultery, it doesn't matter too much. But if your neighbor does, you'll go to hell fire because he didn't happen to be a member of a church and say he was saved. We need to change our tone about sin. You read 1 John and see what John says about it. He says that he, the man that is born of God, doth not, he does not commit sin. What's the difference between a man committing an adultery if he's a Christian, or stealing if he's a Christian, or lying if he's a Christian, to the sin and adultery and lying of a man in the street? There is no difference. There is a difference. Not in the deed, not how diabolical it is. The difference is this, that when a Christian does it, when he's been caught in temptation and does it, he flees to Christ for mercy. He goes with a broken heart. You see, the thing that got to the heart of God with David was this. He says, I've got a broken and a contrite heart. Did you ever have a broken heart? It's worse than a broken limb. It's worse than a broken business deal. It's worse than a broken friendship, a broken heart. My sin, my sin, my sin put him on the tree. And I hate it. I loathe it. I've broken lives. I've hurt my nation. But most of all, I've hurt you, and my heart is broken over this sin. And a broken and a contrite heart, thou desirest not sacrifice. He would have filled the whole valley with sacrifices, but all the blood of beasts on Jewish altars slain could not give one guilty conscience peace or wash away one stain. But Christ the heavenly Lamb takes all our sins away. A sacrifice of nobler name and richer blood than they. Is it amazing that if you sinned for 60 years and you've broken every law in the Decalogue and committed every sin a man could commit, that one drop of the precious blood of Jesus Christ will purge you whiter than snow? You may have a record as foul as any man that ever lived, but such is the gospel of redeeming grace, that if you come with humility and you come with brokenness and contrition, you can be cleansed. You know, a lot of us have been wanting the Holy Spirit without God cleaning the mess up. There's a little cancer down in one area, a grudge you had for years. And you thought like you'd still kind of rub it over and then the Holy Ghost would come in because you said you were sorry. Well, I'm telling you, He won't. You may have got a lift in a meeting and 2 days after you were flat on your face or on your back. You were stumped. And if you couldn't get to a meeting every night, you can't live in victory. Well, you'd never make it in a concentration camp.